Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Hello learners, in today's lecture we will discuss about molecular evidences of evolution from the paper Evolutionary Biology. Now under the module of evidences of evolution, this is our fifth lecture where particularly we will focus on the evidences coming from the molecular biology branch of biology. Earlier we have talked about various evidences coming from different branches of biology. And then we focused particularly on paleontological evidences as per our curriculum. I'm Dr. Sudhir Verma, working in Deen Dayal Upadhyay College as assistant professor in Department of Zoology. Now under this lecture, we will particularly focus upon the evidences of evolution which are coming from the molecular branch or at the molecular level. Then we will talk about the neutral theory of molecular evolution, and lastly we will talk about the molecular clock. So under these three subheads we'll discuss the molecular evidences in today's lecture. In the evidences of evolution at molecular level, we will talk in the terms of the commonality or the universality in terms of genetic material, the structure of the DNA, genetic code and the codon, basic principles of gene expression, and the homology at the sequence level or the molecular sequence level, which comprises of various types of sequence, that is orthologous, xenologous, paralogous, the phenomena of gene duplication and pseudogenes. So let us take them one by one. Starting with the genetic material as such, if you see the genetic material of all the organisms except a few, like the viruses which carry RNA as their genetic material, most of the organisms do have DNA as the genetic material. So this commonality or the universality of the genetic material is the first indication at molecular level that all the organisms have arise from the same organism. Then not just the type of genetic material, but the chemical structure of that. That means the chemical structure of DNA, if you compare, there is a universality with respect to its structure as well. There is a basic backbone of sugar phosphate, the type of nitrogenous bases, that is adenine, thymine, guanine and cytosine, which are also universal, and so on. So at the structural level also, all the DNA which is coming from different organisms, they have the basic common structure. So this is also indicating us to think that all the organisms have evolved from the same basic type. Besides the DNA, the amino acids which are being translated from that also are universal. That means the standard 20 amino acids which we have, which have been listed here and shown in a color coded pattern through show the different biochemical properties that they have. But besides that, these 20 standard amino acids are also common among all the organisms which form different kinds of proteins required for the physiological function of the organism. So there is a universality of the common or standard amino acids as well. Moving ahead, not just the DNA or the genetic material and the amino acids or proteins, there is the commonality in terms of protein synthesizing machinery as well. So if you see the central dogma which we call the DNA, with the influence of various enzymes, gives rise to RNA or mRNA in particular. This mRNA getting spliced, and through translation it is forming the amino acids which comprise of most of the proteins. So this basic mechanism is also same across all the organisms, though minor variations can exist, But the basic principles of protein synthesizing machinery is also same across the organisms. So this universality is also an indication towards evolution from the same organism or single organism. Let's talk about the genetic code. The basic properties when we discuss about the genetic code, we talk about universal genetic code. That means these 64 codons which you see, they comprises of something called code. This code phenomena in itself explains that the basic commonality of this genetic code is existing in all the organisms. Not just that 64 codons are same, but the triplet nature of codon is also same across the organisms. Nowhere you will find a codon comprising of 2 or 4 nucleotides as such. So these commonalities or universalities in terms of genetic code and the codon also indicates us towards the existence of evolution. And these examples are coming from the molecular level. Moving ahead to the sequence homology, that means the homology which is present at the molecular sequence level and something which we call as the homologous genes. So what do we mean by that? Let's try to understand that. If you compare the sequence of a particular protein or a particular gene across the organisms, different organisms, you will find that the sequences can be easily lined up and are very similar. That means the lengthwise they are also similar, and similarity in terms of the position of the amino acids if it is a protein, or nucleotides if it is a gene. Now focus on this particular example. I have just randomly taken an example of an enzyme or a protein called alcohol dehydrogenase, which has been taken from different organisms. So the sequence of alcohol dehydrogenase coming from different organisms like E. coli, Salmonella, Clostridium and so on, when you compare their sequences, they are almost similar. Particularly, I have represented in block letters the iron binding site of this particular enzyme. So if you see, it's almost same. Now, if you compare these along with the different kind of proteins, let's say glycerol dehydrogenase from the Bacillus, this is another protein, but it is a zinc carrying enzyme. So it's a zinc enzyme basically, in contrast to iron binding site which is present in alcohol dehydrogenase. So here you will see there are differences in terms of sequence. So this cannot be compared easily with the other forms of alcohol dehydrogenase, but this molecular similarity at the sequence level is also an indication that this particular protein or enzyme or gene has evolved through the same organism. Now based on this similarity at the molecular sequence level, phylogenetic relationship can be traced out. For example, the phylogenetic tree constructed by comparing the amino acid sequence of cytochrome C. Cytochrome C is another protein. It has been taken from different organisms. The sequence has been compared and the phylogenetic tree has been constructed. The closer the branches are together, the more similar the sequences are. So if you see these two branches which are closer as compared to this, that means these two are more similar as compared to these sequence. The numbers which are being represented here, they show the number of amino acid differences. So this has undergone almost 25 different changes. This has undergone around 12.5 different changes and so on. So based on the molecular sequences, you can compare them and you can create phylogenetic tree which depicts the phylogenetic relationship between the organisms based on the molecular sequences. Now there is a phenomena called as gene duplication and divergence. Multiple duplication followed by sequence divergence may result in a family of related genes that carry out related functions. Let's assume there is an ancestral globin gene. We are taking a globin family of genes example. There is an ancestral globin gene which has undergone the phenomena of duplication. That means this ancestral globin gene has formed another copy of it, which is a duplicated globin gene copy. And because of divergence, this has given rise to hemoglobin, which has undergone mutations at different places. And this has given rise to myoglobin, which has undergone different kind or sets of mutations. So now these two are performing related functions, the oxygen carrying functions. But this is present in blood, this is present in the muscles. So the duplication and divergence has taken place, which has given rise to two related proteins which are carrying out the similar functions. Now, carrying the same example, we have discussed that how globin has given rise to hemoglobin and myoglobin. Now, within the hemoglobin also, there can be a duplication and divergence. For example, the ancestral hemoglobin, which has formed from ancestral globin, it has further duplicated and diverged to form alpha globin and beta globin. Further, this alpha globin has given rise to alpha and zeta. Beta has given rise to gamma, delta, epsilon and beta. So there is a further duplication and divergence within individual hemoglobin or alpha and beta globin genes are there. Now, what we can retrieve from these kind of information, the data sets that help us to order the stages in evolution of five globin genes. You can focus on this particular phylogenetic relationship of globin genes, and you can easily see that myoglobin differs most from these kind of globin genes, and that is why it has been shown as an outgroup, as a different clade here. Now also, the alpha and beta chain differ from each other at 77 amino acids. This is alpha chain, which is 76 here, and beta chain 1 here. So 77 amino acid differences are there. Beta chain differs from gamma chain in terms of 39 amino acids. So 32 plus 6, 38 plus 1, 39 amino acids. Whereas the delta chain differs from beta chain in terms of 10 amino acids. So these kind of data sets are there, which can help us to order the stages of evolution of globin genes. Now, based on this homology which is present in molecular sequences, different terms are there which has been assigned to understand them. These are called as orthologous or paralogous or xenologous sequences. Let us take the example of any ancestral gene X, which has, because of gene duplication, which we just saw in case of globin, has given rise to X.1 and X.2. And these X.1 and X.2, let's assume it has undergone the phenomena of speciation. So X.1 has gone to human and chimpanzee as human X.1 and chimpanzee X.1. X.2 has also undergone speciation to human and chimpanzee as human X.2 and chimpanzee X.2. Now, if you are comparing human X.1 with human X.2, it is a case of paralogous sequences. Whereas, if you are comparing human X.1 with the chimpanzee X.1, this is called as orthologous. So, this is a case of speciation. This human X.1 and human X.2 is a case of duplication. So if it is a duplication based sequences, then we call them as paralogous. Sequences which are arising because of speciation, they are called as orthologous sequences. Now there is something called as analogous, in contrast to all these homologous sequences which we discussed. Analogous is something when we compare it with the different genes. For example, now we are comparing gene X with the some HNS gene which is coming from bacteria. Also, besides orthologous and paralogous, there is something called xenologous sequences. So let's assume gene A, because of speciation, has gone to species 1 and species 2, and there is a horizontal gene transfer, HGT, from species 2 to species 1, because of which species 1 has got gene A1 and gene 2. So these gene A1 and gene A2 represent xenologous sequences. Now to summarize this, we can say the orthologous sequences, they are coming through speciation. Paralogous, they are coming through duplication. And xenolocus, they are coming through lateral transfer. So this is another depiction of what we just saw in case of previous example. This is one gene which has duplicated to form two different type of genes which has undergone the speciation. So based on the gene duplication or speciation or lateral gene transfers, they can be called as orthologous sequences, paralogous sequences, or the xenologous sequences. Now, besides these sequences which are similar, which we just discussed in terms of sequence homology, even stronger evidence for relatedness among different organisms comes from similarity in DNA sequences that have no functions. That means the sequences which carry no functions, which do not have any functional role, their similarity gives a more stronger evidence of evolution or relatedness as compared to the ones which have some functional roles. Now, one of such categories of non-functional sequences is called as pseudogenes. Remember, we talked about the phenomena of duplication and divergence. Now, let's assume a duplication phenomena has occurred. It's not necessary that all the duplicated genes carry out some functions. Many of them can be non-functional as well. And these non-functional category is called as pseudogene. So this is something which we just talked about. The duplicated members of a gene family become functionless at times, instead of all members being active and retaining a function. But they are retained in the genome as pseudogenes. For example, the beta globin clusters, which we just discussed. Not all the derived forms of or duplicated forms which are coming from the globin family, they are functional they do not carry functions always. So there might be some forms which are functionless, and we call them as pseudogenes. Another example can be genes for crystalline proteins and so on. Now, before we move ahead to discuss the role of pseudogenes in case of evolution or how they are being considered as evidence of evolution, let us first talk about how these pseudogenes are formed. Now, let's say this is a common basic principle of protein formation or the central dogma. The DNA or the gene is getting transcribed to RNA, then RNA undergoes splicing to form the processed RNA, and then the amino acids are being translated to form the proteins. Now there are two categories. One is called as classical pseudogene and another one is called as the processed pseudogenes. In case of classical pseudogene, what happens is a gene gets duplicated and there are two genes formed. One can be a functional genes, another one does not carry the functions. So mutation of one gene copy leads to formation of pseudogenes. So duplication is occurring, but one copy remains as functional one, other one undergoes some mutation and causing the pseudogene or the non-functioning gene to form. There is another category called as processed pseudogene. Here, DNA copy of processed RNA. So this processed RNA forms a cDNA and then it gets attached back to the same site, same gene. So there is called as processed pseudogenes. So DNA copy of processed RNA gets inserted back into the cell's DNA to form the processed pseudogene. Now this also does not carry the function. Let us take an example of clustered organization of beta globin type genes as an example of pseudogene, how we are using them as molecular evidences. The gamma globin gene of prosimian primates. Now these prosimian primates, as an example, we can take as a galigo. And the other order, gliers. Gliers comprises of rabbits, rats, mouse and so on. Now they are expressed in the embryonic erythroid cells. We are talking about the gamma globin gene. Whereas in anthropoid primates, which comprises of humans, monkeys and apes, it is expressed only in the fetal erythroid cells. So the expression differs. The embryonic expression here, which is found in case of glides and the prosimian primates, is ancestral as compared to the fetal expression. And fetal expression in anthropoid primates coincides with the duplication of gamma globin genes. Means, in case of anthropoid primates, there is a duplication of gamma globin genes, which forms A gamma globin genes and G gamma globin genes, which is not found in case of other prosimian primates like Galigo here. And here, this is erythroid expression, embryonic erythroid expression. Here it is the fetal erythroid expression. This is more primitive as compared to this one. So what people have suggested that from this, these kind of expression has evolved and it is somehow related with the duplication of gamma globin gene. So we are considering an example of pseudogene, but it is also providing us with the evidence of evolution, and we can retrieve the informations about evolution, which one is primitive, which one is evolved from which one, and so on. And also the common ancestry between, let's say, monkeys, apes and human as compared to the rabbits and rats and so on. So these kind of information can be retrieved from the pseudogenes as well. Now, the relative similarity in functioning genes in different organisms can be because of their similar ways of life. This can be just a justification for the similarity which is being found in the functioning genes. But this possible explanation does not work for the pseudogenes which do not have any function. Rather, the degree of similarity between the pseudogenes must simply reflect their evolutionary relatedness. So, just like the previous examples which we discussed, the A and G gamma globin genes and the similarity between them as compared to the other orders or prosimian primates, they show that they are more related evolutionary. So this kind of evolutionary relationship is being established because of pseudogene similarity. The more close the last common ancestor of the two organisms, the more similar their pseudogenes will be. So here we have discussed that the pseudogenes are establishing the evolutionary relationships, helping us to understand evolution and presenting an example of molecular evidences of evolution. Now, once we have this basic idea of the series of evidences which are coming from molecular biology or the molecular level of life, let us move to something which we call as neutral theory of molecular evolution, which is the second part of our lecture. This neutral theory of molecular evolution was introduced by Japanese biologist Motu Kimura in the year 1968, and independently by two American biologists, Jack Lester King and Thomas Hughes Juke, in the year 1969. Now, let me just read out what Kimura actually said about the neutral theory of molecular evolution. It says that the great majority of evolutionary changes at the molecular level, as revealed by comparative study of proteins and DNA sequences, are caused not by the Darwinian selection, but by the random drift of selectively neutral or nearly neutral mutants. Means, if you perform a comparative study of protein and DNA sequences at the molecular level, the majority of evolutionary changes which you observe, they are not caused by the Darwinian selection, but by the random drift which is occurring at the neutral or nearly neutral sites. This theory does not deny the role of natural selection in determining the course of adaptive evolution, but it assumes that only a minute fraction of DNA changes in evolution are adaptive in nature, while the rest, or the great majority which is left, is of silent molecular substitutions, which exert no significant influence on survival and reproduction, that is the fitness, and drift randomly through the species. So it says, unlike Darwinian selection, which focus on adaptive nature, here the focus is on neutral mutations. And it says that though adaptive mutations can be there, beneficial mutations can be there, but they are rare. Most of the changes are in the neutral mutations. Let us explore this theory more. And let's start with the basic terms that has been used. We talked about the mutations here. So let us talk about what do we mean by the neutral mutations first. The point mutations can be of different types. For example, this is a normal case. Because of a mutation which is silent in nature, the same kind of amino acids can form. In case of nonsense point mutation, a stop codon is formed. The missense mutation can be a conservative one or a non-conservative one. If it is a conservative one, it forms a similar kind of amino acids. For example, instead of lysine, it is forming arginine, which is also physicochemically the similar amino acids as to the lysine. The non-conservative missense point mutation give rise to a different amino acids. So these basic types of point mutations are there, and we can broadly categorize them as synonymous mutations versus non-synonymous mutations. Now, these synonymous and non-synonymous mutations can be given a rate of substitution, which we call as synonymous substitution rate, represented at Ks or Ds, or the non-synonymous substitution rates, which can be denoted as Ka or Dn. Synonymous substitution rate is the rate of substitution of DNA changes that do not change the encoded amino acids, whereas the rate of substitution for DNA changes that do change the encoded amino acids is called as non-synonymous substitution rates. So how we use them in evolution, we'll discuss in the preceding slides. Let's make a point that depending upon the context and the location, whether it is in the coding region or non-coding region, the mutational effects can be classified as either beneficial one, harmful one, or the neutral one. So the mutations can be beneficial for the organisms, harmful for the organisms, or it can be simply neutral, and it depends on the context and the location of the mutation. The mutations that are neither beneficial nor detrimental to carrier's fitness. The word fitness here refers to survival and reproduction, are called as neutral mutations. So in this case, there is no selection. So that means this is invisible to selection, going by the Darwinian view. Here, these kind of mutations do not carry any beneficial roles or the negative roles. So they are not selected by the natural selection and hence remains invisible to it. Hence, their fate is essentially driven by genetic drift. That means the changes in the allele frequencies by genetic drift are random rather than directional as in case of natural selection. So, we are talking about neutral mutations which are not under the influence of natural selection, since they do not carry any beneficial or detrimental roles, and hence they are driven by the genetic drift only. Now, based on these mutations which we discussed, there can be two types of selections or the natural selections. One is called as positive or directional selection, and another one is called as negative or purifying selections. The new mutations that increase the carrier's fitness, that means which are beneficial for the organism, tend to increase in frequency over time until they reach fixation, thus replacing the ancestral allele in the population. This evolutionary process is called as positive or directional selection. In contrast, the new mutation that decreases the carrier's fitness tend to disappear from the population through a process called as negative or purifying selection. So, based on the effect of mutation, there can be two types of natural selection, positive and the negative. Now the question is, how you can detect the type of natural selection, whether it's going to be a positive or negative, depending on the synonymous or synonymous substitution rates which we discussed. You can define that. Means the relative labels for these rates indicate the mode of selection for a gene. For example, if the synonymous substitution rate, that is KS, is almost equal to a non-synonymous substitution rate, which is representing by KA, then it leads to neutral evolution. That means there will be no selection in this case. Whereas, if KS, that is synonymous substitution rate, increases or is more than non-synonymous substitution rates, there will be a purifying selection. If the synonymous substitution rate is less than the non-synonymous substitution rates, there will be a diversifying selection. So, based on the substitution rates of synonymous and non-synonymous mutations, you can detect the type of natural selection that is going to happen. Now, in these lights of discussion about the mutation, synonymous and non-synonymous substitution and their rates, and the two types of natural selection, let us read back the neutral theory of molecular evolution. This neutral theory claims that the overwhelming majority of evolutionary changes at the molecular level are not caused by selection acting on advantageous mutants, but by the random fixation of selectively neutral or nearly neutral mutants through the cumulative effects of sampling drift, which is because of finite population number under continued inputs of new mutations. So, neutral theory of molecular evolution, in contrast to Darwinian natural selection theory, focuses on neutral mutations as compared to the ones which are carrying any benefits or detrimental effects. Neutral theory holds that because most of the mutations are selectively neutral at the molecular level, the majority of evolutionary changes that a macromolecule undergo are because of random genetic drift only and not the natural selection. Much of the variation within the species results from the random genetic drift only. Kimura developed a mathematical model also to show that the rates at which neutral substitution accumulate is a function of mutation rate, not to selection forces. So let us see how mathematically it is being proven.